Yes, shall we start, ma'am? Arlene, ma'am, Rama, ma'am?
Sure.
A very pleasant morning to all the attendees, esteemed faculty members, and research scholars who have joined us today. It gives me great pleasure to welcome you all to day 3 of the Faculty Development Program on Futuristic Trends of Language and Literature Impact on 21st Century Learners, organized by the Department of English and Other Foreign Languages, SRM Institute of Science and Technology, Ramapuram Campus, Chennai. Today we are hosting a live webinar on theatre and its role in French language teaching. And we have in our midst Dr. Adeline Albert, Associate Professor and Head, Department of French, Ethiraj College for Women, Chennai, a very experienced academician in the French field who is going to deliver an enlightening lecture presentation on this topic. Before we move on to the welcome address, I would like to gently remind all the attendees who have joined us today to stay with us till the end of the session to access the quiz and feedback. And please don't forget to post your queries, if any, in the live chat stream on YouTube only during the Q&A session at the end of the presentation. There will also be a mid-session attendance form today. The link will be posted during the session at any time at around 11:30. I would like to gently remind you all to fill that form also, which will hardly take up a minute of your time, and then you can return to the lecture immediately after. I would like to now call upon Dr. Rama, Professor and Head, Department of English and Other Foreign Languages, to deliver the welcome address. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you, Walter. Good morning, friends. We have come to the third day of the 1 week FDP on Futuristic Trends of Language and Literature Impact on 21st Century Learners. We are smooth sailing into day 3, and I'm very happy to welcome all the enthusiastic participants. From English language and literature, we move today to an interesting and widely learned foreign language, French. We have amidst us today Dr. Adeline Albert, Associate Professor and Head, Department of French, Ethiraj College for Women, Chennai, who will take us through the role of theatre in French language teaching. I thank you, ma'am, most heartily, and I welcome you. And now I hand the forum over to my colleague, Dr. Walter.
Thank you, ma'am. I would like to say a few words about Dr. Adeline Albert. Dr. Adeline Albert has been associated with teaching French as a foreign language since 1994. She joined the Department of French, Ethiraj College for Women, Chennai in the year 2000, and is currently Associate Professor and Head. She is well known in the field of French and appears on several board of study, academic audit teams, and staff selection committees. She was awarded the prestigious European Union Erasmus Mundus Fellowship in 2008, with which she visited 3 European universities in France, the UK, and Portugal in connection with teaching and research activities. Her area of interest covers comparative literature, especially between Indian and Francophone literature, and short stories, in which she has done considerable research besides publishing several articles. Her third area of interest is pedagogy of French as a foreign language, and she is passionate about creating innovative strategies to alleviate boredom and monotony in the classroom. In this context, she has been sent thrice to France by the French government to participate in teaching modules. In order to combat the photocopy culture, she co-authored a reasonably priced teaching manual in 2 volumes for French students, Le Tramway Volant. Her present project is the creation of a manual to facilitate Tamil medium students in learning French. She has received the Excellent Teacher Award in Non-Indian Languages conferred by the Tamilaga Institute for Educational Research and Advancement in Chennai on 5th September 2017. She has served as the treasurer of the Executive Committee of the Alliance Française of Madras and also as its president for two terms, 2015-19. Since November 2016, she has been nominated to the post of South Zone Treasurer of the Indian Association of Teachers of French for a period of three years. With this, I come to an end of this profile, and I would like to hand over the session to Adeline, ma'am. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you, Walter. Good morning, everybody. Bonjour à tous. And first, let me commend the Department of English and Other Foreign Languages of the SRM Institutes for having thought about this week-long FDP, not only in one particular language, but in several languages. I think this is the first time that such a webinar or any FDP program online has been organized. I'd really like to commend them. Let me also thank sincerely Dr. Rima, the head of the department, and Dr. Walter for having given me the opportunity to present my thoughts on theatres. So without any further ado, let me go into my presentation, Theatre and its Role in French Language Teaching. Now, I'm not going to give a very theory-based talk. This is a subject that is very dear to my heart, and I will be presenting you certain ideas on how to use theatre in teaching French within and outside the classroom. Now, I have always been fascinated by theatre because as a young child when I saw my first drama, and later as a young adult, and I continued relishing drama, and I realized it was not like a movie. The director did not have the opportunity to stop every time there was a mistake and ask the actors to start once again. And I love the idea of a group of people coming together and overcoming each other's faults and improvising on stage so that a certain topic could be passed without any interruption to the public. And I always loved teaching theater. When I was a BA French teacher and an MA French teacher, it was easy to include theater because you're there with the students for more than four semesters all through the day, and it's easy to make them understand theater and its importance. But right now, I am, for the past 20 years, I'm a second language teacher. And as a second language teacher, part one French, I used to always look at theater with a lot of fear, because I was wondering how will a class that joins me in the first semester, where there's so many beginners, how do I teach them theater? So that is what has been pushing me for quite a long time now. But a few years back, I realized that acting and drama is second nature to us human beings. If you go to any competition in any college or school, one of the most famous competitions that are held is Dhamsharads. And what is Dhamsharads but theater? One person acting and one person, a group of people trying to understand what that person says. And if you look at our children, small children walking in their parents' shoes, and they're trying to put on their parents' clothes, walking around with a towel as a veshti or as a sari, that again is theater. And look at our own students. All of us know how wonderful our students are when it comes to trying to act innocent, and that they're very capable. They're very good actors. So this acting is second nature to the human being. And I think that capitalizing on this and bringing the students in to utilize those characteristics in the French classroom is actually a very big tool that will help students memorize lines and play them out, speak them out in real time. So that is the basis on which I have founded this presentation. I will be talking to you in four major parts. In the first part, I will talk about the diversity and the tradition, rich tradition that theater has in France. and its presence online and offline, because our managements have always been telling us to use a lot of ICT in our teaching methods. People like me are very lazy when it comes to ICT. So one of the small positives of this pandemic situation is that we are forced to go online and we are forced to integrate resources and activities that we find online inside the virtual classroom. So I'll be talking about all this in the first part of the presentation. The second part of the presentation, I will be showing you some of my favorite drama extracts, and it will be an interactive session because we'll be discussing together how to use these extracts in teaching French. The third part of my presentation will be activities that can be done within the classroom. And finally, we will talk about activities that can be outside the classroom. I hope to make this session as interactive as possible, because one of the biggest drawbacks of online presentation is that people are not able to interact with the resource person. So with a method that the Department of English and other foreign languages has come up with, I think we can make this session as interesting as possible, interactive as possible. So without further ado, let me go to my first slide. Why do I want to present French dramatic tradition to my students? It's because it is such a diverse tradition. When France was founded in the medieval ages, simultaneously theater started, because in those days, theater was a very exclusive property of the church, if I can call it that. In those days, people were illiterate and they spoke in various dialects of French, and the language of the church was Latin. So the church priests decided that they would enact scenes from the Bible, biblical illustrations of the life of Jesus or doctrines of the church through plays. And these plays were known as mysteries. So when the people in the church watched what was happening, they would understand better than a lecture in Latin. But if you have had the opportunity to visit a cathedral or an ancient cathedral or a church in France, you will realize that they are very long, very big. So people who are in the middle of the church or towards the end of the church near the exit door could hardly hear or see what was happening in the front. So slowly theater was brought out of the church onto the porch. And the play would be done on the stage there on the porch, and the people would stand down in the courtyard and they would see what was happening. But again, with the evolution of time, the priests realized that they were spending too much time on these plays or mysteries, as they called them, les mystères. So they called the leading people, and the leading people in those days were the guilds, the merchant associations, and they told the guilds, you take over the presentation of these mysteries or religious plays. And the guilds were very happy to do that. And since now it was in the hands of the lay people, slowly comedies and farces came in. And you had two distinct genres from the beginning itself. You had mysteries that were based on the Bible, and you had comedies that were based on everyday life. So this was what was happening during the medieval age, which is a very long period of time. And slowly, when you go into the 16th century, the king realized that theater was a huge tool that he could use to promote himself. So the court started to become the patron of certain guilds, which had transformed themselves into theaters, because the king realized that if he could pay the theater and if he could pay the playwright, and those people wrote good things about him and of his monarchy and of his government, then the audience would have a good idea, a very good positive outlook on his administrative skills. So this was what happened during the 16th century. Theater became very focused, very official, and was recognized by the crown. And slowly, with the passage of the years in the 16th century, it continued developing, and two basic genres developed. One was tragedy, because they decided no longer to base themselves on the Bible, but to include classics from Greek literature, etc. But that was tragedies, and you also had comedies. So when you go into the 17th century and you come face to face with one of the biggest, most important kings of France, Louis XIV or Louis XIV, he was the sun king. He believed he was the son of God and he believed he was the sun. And when the sun rose up in the morning, he rose up. And when the sun went to sleep, he slept. So that was the idea he had of being a king. And he took a keen interest in theater. He formalized all the rules. It became a very big, it was the literary way of reaching the masses. But once again, there was a big distinction between tragedy and comedy. Both could not be mixed. But towards the end of his rule and the beginning of the 18th century, things changed. You know that the 18th century was the beginning of the revolution. And towards the end of the century in 1789, you had the French Revolution that rocked not only France, but entire Europe. And once again, the revolutionists realized that theater was a wonderful way of talking to the masses and speaking to them about their ideas. And rules were slightly changed, but not much. And most of the playwrights of this 18th century have brought out wonderful dramas on wonderful themes that talk about the rights of people and the crushing way tyrannical governments block them out. So when you go into the 19th century now, there is one more evolution that you can see. Because now 19th century, like all over Europe, was the century for romantic literature. And romantic literature was not about romance, as many people think, but it was about a hero who believed in love and passion and feelings and emotions. And this was in direct contrast to the classical hero of the 17th century, for whom duty and honor was more important. So the hero, the romantic hero, had both parts in him. He had this fight between love and duty, between passion and honor. And the playwrights in the 19th century thought it was not correct to have it as two separate categories, tragedies and comedies. So they blended them together and they developed what is known as melodramatic drama, in which you had heroes who were very emotional and sentimental. And this was what happened in the 19th century. You had a play now which had definite comic aspects and definite dramatic aspects. And when you go into the 20th and 21st century, there was an explosion of themes, because now people had really understood the importance of theater and they used it to talk about their feelings. So there are many literary movements that have used theater successfully to reach out to the masses. But now we can see that in the past, up to the 20th century, a lot of importance was given to dramatic backgrounds, panoramas and dioramas, etc. But in the 20th and 21st century, the background faded. What was important was the way the actor stood out and how he was able to speak or emote or make oral the ideas of the playwright or the director. So this is a beautiful setting for a language teacher like me, because I do not have a beautiful background. Many of us don't have that much money to form a background for a drama, but we do have the language. We do have students who are able to understand that language and speak it out in a beautiful way. Of course, if we decide to work on a drama from the medieval ages, we have to rework the script, as you can see here, because the language can be tough. But apart from that, you can understand why theater is so important now for teaching as a tool, because when you make a student read a beautiful verse from the 17th century or the 18th century or the 19th century or the 20th century for that matter, and you make that person memorize it, it'll improve that person's intonation and rhythm, because the way the lines, I'm sure it's like that in any language, the lines that have been brought out by playwrights are very well researched and they're chosen for their rhythm and the intonation. Therefore, the students' speech patterns improve. And not only that, as a French teacher, we call to speak to the students not only about languages, but also about culture and civilization. So when you present a drama to them and you talk to them about a theme that a playwright in the 17th century spoke about, and then you realize that that theme is the same today, students realize that cultures may change, but our focus and our humanity remains the same. So this is what French dramatic tradition has to offer to French teachers. Now, let us go to the diversity of theater as a teaching tool. It is available in many formats, written format, book format. You have the video format, you have so many on YouTube today, and also on various websites, which I'll be showing you shortly, and also audio format. So all of them, the written format gives you a chance to read. The video format allows you to hear and see, and the audio format allows them once again to hear and speak possibly. So theater as a tool is able to address all the four or five competencies that basic language teachers have to address in the classroom. Now, the first one, you know, is hearing, or la compréhension orale, hearing skills. And audio, for this you need the audio format, and you can find, there's so many websites now that allow you to access audio formats of plays that have been staged in France. Now, of course, this you have to search in order to find the playwright you want, the play you want, and within the play, the actual scene you want to recreate in your classroom. So instead of spending such a long time doing this, an easier method is to get your seniors who passed out and who are still there in college. You call them back in and you ask them to help them reenact a play just by reading it, and you record it, and you have an audio tool now which you can use in the classroom. So theater can be transformed into an audio tool that you can use in the classroom. That is the first competency. The second competency is reading. Read it and understand what is presented to you in a paper format or as a virtual document. Ça, c'est la compréhension écrite. Now, recently, just 1 month back or 2 months back, I discovered this wonderful Google extension called Immersive Reader. I'm sure many of you have heard about it, but I was thrilled when I found this, because you just have to download this extension into your computer, and you have to change your settings to allow text to language in French. And once you install that and download whatever is necessary, if you open any document in a Word file, or if you open any document online, this, and you open the immersive reader, it reads it for the student, highlighting each syllable. You can increase the speed or you can decrease the speed. So when the student, who normally my students hate reading, but when you give them a tool like this, because they have to keep asking you, ma'am, how do you pronounce, how do you pronounce? And finally we end up yelling at each other. So if you give them a tool like this and say, okay, you don't need to ask me every time, but just read and listen to the person on the computer who's reading along with you, this really perks them up, because when they're free, whenever they have time, they can read. They don't have to depend on the teacher. They have this extension which is downloaded onto their system. And the French voice is actually very much better. It's beautiful compared to the English voice, which is very robotic in nature. So if you have not used this extension, I think you should use it, because you should tell your students also to use it, because it really encourages reading. The third and fourth competence that French teachers have to focus on is speaking skills, either as a single person giving a monologue or a tirade or whatever, and as a group when you listen to people and you understand what is happening and improvise. Ça, c'est l'expression orale. So once again, theater is a beautiful tool for exploiting this aspect in class. And finally, you have writing. You give them any form of theater and they can write based on what you ask them to do. So you can see that all the competencies, expression orale, expression écrite, compréhension orale, and compréhension écrite, can be exploited in class with theater as a teaching tool. And if you combine hearing, speaking, and writing skills together, you can actually put up a play. It need not be restricted only to what can be done inside the classroom, but you can take the children out of their desks to the front of the classroom, outside the classroom, and you can make them stage a play. So this makes you see how diverse theater can be used as a teaching tool. Now, where do we go for resources? That is everybody's questions today, because not everybody has a developed library on theater. Even my library in college has only maybe about 10 plays. But you can go online. You can find everything online. You just have to spend some time. I've been able to bring out two websites. One is Bonjour de France, and the other is Loeb Pédagogique. They have wonderful exercises that are didacticized. The person who has formed them has already thought of exercises and has already installed answers. So the student just has to do it, and the computer automatically tells the student whether he or she is wrong or correct. But there are not very many websites that focus on language, French theater. So what I would recommend is searching online for drama in PDF formats. There are two websites here. One is toumouliere.net. You know, Moulière was a comedy drama playwright from the 17th century. And you also have libtheatre.fr, where you have quite a lot of plays. You have them in both the PDF format and also in the video format. So this is where you can go online to find a play if you do not have it in your library. Now, this is for online teaching. Of course, teachers like me, as I've said before, we prefer offline teaching, but we have to evolve. Otherwise, we might soon become extinct like the dinosaurs. I realized recently that I'm a fossil when it comes to technology. I've even told Walter about this. I'm really bad when it comes to technology. So I think that we all have to start focusing on how we can use what we can find on the net to be exploited in class. Offline teaching, it is easy to get a book and take a Xerox and take a photocopy, and you can send it to your students via WhatsApp or their Google Classroom, or you can even write it on the board. But you can see how easily we can use theater both for online teaching and offline teaching. Now, having said that, I will now move on to the next part of my presentation, which will be slightly interactive. Now, this is the first part of a very famous play called Rhinoceros. It was a play in three acts, and it had four tableaux. A tableau is a description of the background scene. And when I looked at this, I realized that this can be used in my first semester class, A1. I needn't wait till the end of the third semester or the beginning of the fourth semester to introduce that drama to my students. I can introduce it to them using this part of any play for that matter, where you have the presentation of the personalities or the characters along with their roles. This is known as the dramatis personae. It's a Latin word, dramatis personae, the people in the drama. So maybe now we will go over to the audience, and they could give us their ideas on how we can use this particular document in the classroom. So if you have any ideas on how we can use this particular document in the classroom, you can share it on the chat group, and I think the questions will be you have any ideas, think of your first semester students, French teachers, or if you're an English or Japanese or German teacher. Now, for those who do not know French, it is, like I said, it is a presentation of the various characters. So you have the ménagère, who's a housewife or a maid. You have L'épicière, who's the wife of the grocer. You have Jean and Béranger, who are characters. You have La Serveuse, who's a waitress. Épicier, the green grocer. You have a vieux monsieur, a logicien, Monsieur Papillon. So you can see all the characters and their descriptions. So if you have any ideas on how this document can be used in the classroom, you can tell me what you think.
There is one participant who says learning professions.
Yes, very good. Very good. Yes, yes, excellent. That was what I thought when I first saw it. How to learn professions.
Role playing is another.
Yes, yes. Anything else?
By merging online resources along with this document, one participant has mentioned. By merging online resources along with this document.
You can merge it with Google Extension, the immersive reader, and it'll read it out for the students. And you can easily share this document with your students with the reader speaking it out. So yes, you can make them read how to learn how to read. You can teach them professions. Now, those who are French teachers, you will understand that in professions, you have the problem of gender. You have masculine and feminine. So you can talk to them about gender. And there's another thing that I found very interesting when I saw this document. It's the teaching of phonetics. I don't know if you thought about that. Teaching of phonetics, especially the sound E. And you have the sound E in EPCA. You have the E there. You have the sound E in logicien. You have the sound in papillon, pompier, plusieurs. So I feel this document is very ideal. Like you rightly said, you can use it to teach professions. You can use it to talk about gender differences, how to form the masculine and the feminine part. You can use it for reading using online resources. And you can also use it for speaking, helping them learn how to pronounce that very irritating French sound E. Yeah. So we'll go on to the next slide, which is another. Now, this is something I found about 2 or 3 months back when I was asked to start online classes. It's an English website called armoredpenguin.com. And this allows you to make word vocabulary exercises for your students. The first one is a word search puzzle, and I've done one for you here. I've given the list of words from the play that we just saw. I've given them at the side, and the website, which is a very easy one. Like I told you, I'm a fossil when it comes to technology. So I like simple things. And this website is a very simple thing. It helped me bring out this document. And now all I have to do is I have to print it out in the HTML format or the PDF format, or I can just save it as a soft copy and I can use it online. And the students will have to memorize the spellings. I will not give them the words at the side. I'll just tell them, look at the document which had come previously. Look at the document and try and find out the professions here. So they have to learn their spellings to be able to do that. Now, this website, armoredpenguin.com, also helps you do crossword puzzles, which students like to do. And it's easy because on one side, you write down the word, for example, Pompier. And on the other side, you write the description or the clue that will be displayed on the crossword, and the computer does the rest for you. Word scramble puzzles look sophisticated, but it's not. It's what French teachers love a lot. You take a sentence or a word, and the computer puts the spelling into disorder, and now the student has to put them into the correct order. And finally, word matches, which is, again, a very popular tool among French teachers. We call it appareiller or lier les éléments des deux colonnes, colon A et colon B. So on one side you have, for example, the professions, and on the other side you will have the description of the profession, and the student will have to link them up because the computer mixes them up for you. So this is a wonderful tool that I'm using now, and I think that you can use it not only for A1 classes, but for the first year classes, but for all 4 semesters of teaching French. It's a wonderful tool that you can use. Having said that, let's go to the next extract. The first part comes here. It is the same play that I had spoken of earlier, Eugène Ionesco's Rhinoceros. Now, this is the first tableau, or the first background, the first act. And the second part is here on the next slide. And over here, you can see the online platform on which I found it. It is a school platform. Now, over here in the first slide, in the first paragraph, it is a description of the marketplace, of the center of the village or the town. Gives you very detailed description of the center of the town. And then you have an épicerie, the épicerie description of the greengrocer, very detailed description. And the third paragraph, avant le lever du rideau, just before the curtain go up, on entente carillonner, it gives you the background music or sound that you need for staging your play. And in the final part of the description or the tableau, you have a description of Jean, and he comes in par la gauche, il est soigneusement vêtu. Along with him, there's this character known as Béranger, and that's a Béranger n'est pas rasé, il est tête nue. So you have two personalities who come in and you have their description. So once again, let's go back to the, tell me what you can, because I feel that this document as a paper tool can be used in class to teach something to the students. So if you focus on your first semester or your second semester activities, can you briefly share with me how you can use this in a classroom to teach French? There are two parts here, remember. You have a description of the background, you have a description of the village or the city, you have a cafe described, you have the épicerie or the greengrocer described, the building. You also have the greengrocers standing outside looking at the characters who come in. You have descriptions there also. So let's see how we can use this in the classroom. If there are any suggestions.
Find the words, adjectives, adverbs, and nouns.
Yes, very good. Vocabulary exercises, very good. Yes. You can use it very easily for grammar classes. Yes. Excellent idea. I never thought of that. Huh? I can use it to teach grammar. I was only focusing on vocabulary.
So yes, see, articles, gender of nouns, like vocabulary, they have mentioned a few participants.
Yes.
Then one has mentioned Dr. Albert, world behind the text.
Ah, yes. Yes.
Visualizing scenes, grammar and sentence construction.
Very good. Very good.
Les lieux, le vocabulaire, les prépositions.
Yes. Yes.
Role play.
Yes, role play. The two aspects that those two participants spoke about, visualizing the text. Actually, it's a beautiful, see, in a classroom, I've realized that there's some children who like talking, there are some children who like writing, and there's some teachers, children who we do not focus on as teachers. We should correct that. But these students love seeing, they love looking at a text and visualizing it. And if you could find, there are students like that in our classes. Each class has at least one or two people who are very good artists. So if you give them this text, which is so detailed, and you tell them, visualize it and draw it for me, and I will put it up in the classroom, or I'll put it all up on my Facebook page or something, it makes them excited and they want to delve into the passage and they try to recreate, understand it and recreate it in the form of a picture. And nowadays it is much more easier because you have so many apps that students know how to use with which they can literally visualize the text into a picture. So yes, visualizing a text like this can be used for those students who know how to read and understand, but who are scared to open their mouths and speak. And therefore you tell them, draw it. You either write it down and describe it to me, or you draw it and I will use the drawing in some form or the other. Now, another aspect that you can use this very easily in the first semester itself is we have this theme in all our manuals, whichever manual you look at, it is la présentation des personnages, la présentation des endroits, des lieux. So if you teach them, give them such a document, you don't even need to explain it to them. They will be able to easily understand it because we have already taught them a similar description of a house or a city or a commercial establishment. And like I said, in the second part, you have la présentation, la description des personnages. You have people there and you have both a positive way, a nice way of presenting a person as Jean, and you have a person like Béranger who is not very well presented. So this document, which comes from the same 20th century play, I've not changed anything. It is directly from the PDF form I found online. I didn't need to change anything because it is very simple language and our first year students can easily understand if we exploit such a document in class. Now, another thing you can do is, just to have fun, you can ask them to reenact such a scene in class. But we'll be discussing this later, so let me not run ahead. Let's go on to the third play. Now, this is a play called Verithie et le mensonge des dieux by K. Madhavan. It's an Indian author of a French play. And it's not clear because I took a photo from a book, but I'll just read the first two paragraphs for the French lecturers. Au lever du rideau, la scène entière est voilée d'une fumée blanche et épaisse qui va disparaître progressivement. Les spectateurs doivent découvrir petit à petit le véritier dont la religiosité est visible sur scène. Raghu Murli et Suri entrent sur scène avec une démarche lente et prudente qui indique leur peur de l'inconnu. Ce sont des artistes de Terukuttur qui n'ont pas eu le temps de se débarrasser entièrement de leur maquillage et costume. Ils ont raté leur dernier bus. Now, this document, when I read it, I was really excited by it because nowadays people are asking us to include Indian culture and Indian heritage into our French teaching. So when you have a document like this written by an Indian author or playwright or poet, and it's available in French, I think we teachers should seize upon it at once, because over here you have this concept of a religious tree. You find them in all villages and all corners of our city. You have these dignified looking beautiful trees next to a small temple, and this is concentrating on that because the Verithie, as you know, is the truth tree which is found near the temple. And over here you have artists in their costumes of Terukuttu. Terukuttu, you know, is the Tamil form of street theater, and all these terms can be discussed in class. So students love such activities, you know, because they love horror. My students love horror. I don't know about yours, but over here you give them something about three artists who are lost and they stumble into the center of the village and they see this mysterious tree and the tree is covered with smoke, and you can just imagine what they would start thinking about. This cannot be used in the first year. Maybe you can use it in the third semester to instigate students to talk about horror, maybe. Think about a fitting horrific ending or a good ending. If anyone has any ideas about how to use this in the class, I thought we can use it for making them talk about different genders in the third semester or fourth semester, write a similar play on a mysterious happening in your home or a mysterious happening in a city. So that can be done. We'll go on now to the last part of this second part, which is a beautiful play which I absolutely love. It's called Le Voyage de Monsieur Perrichon, and the playwright is Eugène Laviche. Now, it comes in several pages. I have cut and copied and stuck them together. But this is set in the 19th century. You can see the language is very simple. And my students put this up and they enjoyed reenacting this, because it's simple things like Parisi means come here. And once the child memorizes Parisi, she will remember it forever. Parisi means come here. Nonu kitampa, don't leave us, let's stay together. Uso no bagage. You know, students are always using such sentences in English, and now you have a play in which they can see and hear it in French. Now, what I'd like to show you is the next part. You can look at the bottom of this slide over here. Madame Perrichon at the end says, là, quand je te disais que nous avions le temps, tu ne nous as pas laissé déjeuner. He hurried them up. The father hurried up the family because he wanted them to go on time to the train station, which is like so many fathers who push us to enter the train station well ahead of time. And poor Madame Perrichon could not eat her lunch. Now look at the next slide. Apar, he tells it apar. Apar is an aparte in which he tells the audience in a very loud whisper, and she pretends she hasn't heard it, you know, and he says, elle est comme ça, she's like that. Chaque fois qu'elle n'a pas pris son café, so she's not had her coffee, she's not really had her breakfast, I'm sorry, not lunch, and therefore she's in a bad mood. But if you look at the previous slide, and if you look at this slide, I have cut out quite a bit in between because it was a very long scene and there were some complicated sentences in between. But I have changed it into a very simple scene now, and I have not lost the continuity of the act. So over here you have the first scene, you have the family rushing into the train station. In the second page, you have everybody searching for everyone and finding out whether they are on time and etc. And in the third part of the scene, you have Monsieur Perrichon who's counting his baggage. And deux, trois, quatre, cinq, six, ma femme, sept, ma fille, huit, et moi, neuf, nous sommes neuf. It's typically what happens when a large family is traveling for the first or second time. And I find this can really be used within the classroom and outside the classroom. It's a wonderful play that can be used either in the second semester. You can use it to increase numbers. To teach them numbers, you can basic speaking skills. You can use it also for lampafé. Is there anything that anyone has to say about how to use this extract? It's there in two slides, so I don't know how this is the first slide. Ne nous quittons pas, impératif. Où sont nos bagages?
They have mentioned socio-cultural, teaching the socio-cultural background, and then dialogue writing and dialogue.
Yes, yes, wonderful. Yes, wonderful, wonderful. Social cultural background. Yes, over here, if you can see my arrow, you see il est resté dans le fiacre, because this was in the 19th century. There were no cars, there were no taxis. They came in a horse carriage. So you can talk to them about culture in the 19th century. Panama, nobody uses a Panama these days, but in those days, all men had to have hats. Even women had to wear hats. It was compulsory. It was a sign of gently bred men and women. So yes, you can use this to talk about culture. Is there any other... you can use it to help them count. In A1 level, you can easily teach them how to count.
Summarizing also, the dialogue.
Very good, yes.
Choice from of words can reflect the character.
Very good. Excellent. Excellent, yes.
Gerondi.
From the play. Gerondif, yes. I can also add.
Past history.
Past history, very good, yes. Along with Gerondif, I think we can easily talk about questions. So you can see the venues that are opened when you have a simple play like this and you use it in class. It need not be part of your syllabus. Many times at the end of the, towards the end of the class hours, our students are tired, and now that we're all going to start online teaching in August, sitting for me, I cannot sit for more than half an hour. I can imagine how my students feel. But if you give them activities like this online and say, okay, let's read this together or read this play, like somebody said, and write a paragraph of what you understand, I think this will add more vibrancy to our teaching. Okay, so now we come to the third part of my presentation on what can be done inside the classroom. Now, since I have a large classroom, I have students who are good learners and I have students who are not so good learners. I think we all should start learning to put students together in groups. So it's better to have three in a group, but since we have large classes, maybe you can have five in a group. One person is the leader because she's the boss lady or he's the boss lady. They don't do anything much. They just boss everybody around and get things done. The secretary is the person who writes down the ideas, and the speaker is the one who speaks it out and makes sure the others understand pronunciation. And then you have the other two group members. Now, each group should have a dictionary. Over the years, I've built up a language dictionary bank in my department, but now I'm at home. I don't have access to this dictionary bank, but there's so many wonderful translators online. There's so many translation apps online, but I think the teacher should tell the student, I think you should use this website. I prefer the students using the Collins website. It's very easy. It even has a small microphone that speaks out the word that the children are searching for. Apart from that, you can give them a vocabulary sheet. Don't just tell them work on a perfect, on a certain theme. Give them hints to develop their theme. Give them the vocabulary they need. And also tell them, I need this by Monday or Tuesday, or I need it in 10 minutes or 20 minutes or 5 minutes, because otherwise they are indefinite when they start talking together. Somebody had mentioned earlier role plays in class. Yes, role plays are very, very important. Very, very important. And in the first semester itself, if you're a language teacher, you have these themes which are there in almost all the manuals, the level one manuals, in the canteen, in the bookshop, in the clothes shop, in the market, at the hospital, on vacation, recipe, learning. And it is very interesting to see what students do, because I remember once we had a role play in class on how to make recipes, various recipes. I always insist that my students bring props. If they can't bring props, they bring in pictures drawn. And after the role play is over, I confiscate those pictures and I take them to my departments. My department is quite colorful. Every year I keep changing the pictures. So I remember this particular class in which we had taught them how to write recipes and how to use the emparative and all that. And students had come to class, they had brought pressure cookers, they had bought lentils, they had bought rice. And at the end of the presentation, they gave all of us a spoonful of nice, tasty pongal. So it not only livens up the class, role plays not only liven up the class, but it also gives children who do it, gives them certain joy. And in Ethiraj College, we have something known as participation marks, in which the way you participate in mark is rewarded by a the way you participate in class is rewarded by a mark. So students really put their effort into such activities. Now, how do you do these role plays online? I've not yet discovered. I'm putting my thoughts together, because we will have to start soon. But I have discovered a concept known as breakout rooms. Yes, it's available on Zoom. It is not there on Google Meet. But in a Google Meet, instead of having one huge class with 70 students online, you can have lots of small classes with maybe 5 to 6 people in a group, and that will be your group, which will work on the role play. And after they work on the play, the teacher has to create these small mini meeting rooms, and you can easily keep visiting each room to make sure that they're talking about the play and not talking about the latest movie that was released. But after that, the next day, perhaps, you can ask them to read individually their parts in the Google class or on the Zoom platform, and they would be able to do the role play individually from their various houses or where they are sitting in isolation. So I think this is something that we have to think about, because although our teaching methods are changed now, but we still have to think of ways and means of making students interested in what is happening. So rather than listening to the teacher nonstop, if you can think of mini Zoom classrooms or mini Google Meets and make the students work together like that. If they don't want to do a mini Google Meet, you can ask them to work on WhatsApp on a small mini group. But whatever groups that are created, make sure that you're there on the group so that you can monitor what is being done. And that is a way of making them do role plays through group work online. Now, what are the other things you can do inside the class? Many of us have poems, we have short stories. We can make the lesson a base. We can make a lesson the base for a play. We can convert the short story into a play. We can convert a poem into a play. Or we can show them a short scene from a movie and ask them to imagine a skit based on it. And this is something I'm planning to do this next semester. I'm planning to show them a mute movie with Charlie Chaplin, maybe a few minutes of this mute movie. And I'm going to ask them to write it, the dialogue, as they imagine in French. So it's a form of dumb charades. It's a movie. You can imagine it's a theater, and you can ask them to imagine a play based on the movie. And maybe once a year, all your best plays can be put up for the entire French student body, which is something we do. Because I realized that in my college, we had French Dramatics Club and we had Tamil Dramatics Club, and we didn't have anything for French. So last year, we started the French Dramatics Club, and it was very exciting with what my students came up with. Now, pour aller plus loin, what else can we do? Give them a scene from a play, like I told you about Le Veritier by Mr. K. Madhavan. You can give them that scene from a play and ask them to imagine the ending. Or you can give them a second scene from the play and ask them to imagine the beginning. You can give them either scene one and scene three and ask them to imagine the central theme. All should be done in groups at the beginning level, otherwise children will be stalled. They won't be able to go forward. You can give them various vocabulary and comprehension exercises, like all of you have shared in the interactive session. You have shared that you understand that we can use this for comprehension and vocabulary. And now I'm going to add grammar to this because I hadn't thought of that before this. You can use it to improve their reading. And an extra thing that you can do is you can work on vocabulary related to theater by asking them to do a project on how to put up a play. Now, when I was thinking about this, I realized that the lexicon of a theater is so different from the lexicon of normal life. And I found these terms that we use in our normal life, like corbeille and poulailler and loge and baignoire, but they have nothing to do with these actual terms when you think of theater. For example, corbeille is a basket. When I looked at it, I thought basket. And I was wondering what a basket is doing inside a theater. But a corbeille is actually the VIP rooms. If you see not the modern theaters, but the ancient theaters, you would have rooms on the walls, lining the walls, in which the rich people sat in, and those were known as baskets. They were basket cases, if you can push it, because they were the royal people, the nobles. They will not mix with the normal people. They would sit in the corbeille. The next term is this thing called poulailler. A poulailler is a hen coop where chickens are kept, a cage. But inside the theater, the poulailler was the furthest mezzanine, right at the top. It was also called the paradise because it was very close to heaven. And this was the cheap seats, because when you sat in the poulailler, you could hardly see the scene and you could hardly hear what was being spoken, because in those days, remember, there was no mic system, there was no audio system. So the poulailler was the furthest away from the stage, and people sitting there were like chickens in a coop, and they couldn't really understand what was happening on stage. Therefore, they were very cheap. And then you had the loge. The loge is not a lodge like in English, but it's the green room. I never knew that. When I started working with theater, I understood this. And then you have baignoire. A normal French teacher will think of a bathtub. But a baignoire inside a theater is not a bathtub. It is the royal room, you know. It was the private rooms, the two private rooms directly above the scene, the theater scene. So the king normally used to sit there. It was a royal VIP room. If the king was not in attendance, it will be empty. It was reserved only for the king and for his close relatives or his close financial political advisors. And he was directly above the scene, so he had first-hand view. He had first-hand audio senses also. So that is the baignoire. The parterre is the ground floor. And you can also talk to them about various terms that we use in theater, like quiproquo, which I have not put on the slide. A quiproquo is when it's a comedy technique in which I think somebody is someone else, and the person knows that I'm confused, and he confuses me further. And you also have coup de théâtre, which is used in English, but it's a French term, in which you have a complicated situation and the students are supposed to use their imagination and bring out something that solves the problem. You have the aparté, which is not apartheid, like one of my students said, but it is a technique, as I've told you, we saw it in Monsieur Perrichon. He talks directly to the audience, and the person he's speaking about pretends she or he hasn't listened to him. And elocution, everybody thinks about context, but elocution is actually how you deliver your lines. And then it becomes a competition. So there's so much in theater that you can talk about your students and to make them appreciate the world of theater better. So let's finally go to the last part of my presentation, which is how do you enact a play? Now, these are plays I love. The first one, La Farce de Mère Patelin, is from the medieval ages. If you have a copy of the original text, you will not be able to understand it because it was old French. I have come across PDF forms of this play in modern language, but I think we can still work on it and make it simpler. It's a very beautiful, simple comedy. It just has five people. You have the advocate, Monsieur Patelin, who has cheated a clothes shop man. And he pretends he's very sick and he's dying, so the clothes shop man stops asking him for his money. But finally, they end up one day in front of the judge because the drapist, his shepherd, has stolen his sheep and eaten them. So the drapist has brought the shepherd to the court. And he recognizes Mr. Patalan there, who pretended he had died and therefore didn't have to reimburse him for the cloth he had purchased. And it's a comedy because the judge is completely confused. And to add comedy, Mr. Patalan tells the shepherd, "You only have to say bear so that I will tell the judge that you can't speak, that you are challenged, you're physically challenged, you can't speak, and this man is exploiting you." So you have the judge shouting at them, trying to understand whether they are killing sheep or selling cloth. You have Mr. Patalan pretending he doesn't know who the drapist is. You have the drapist who's saying he stole my cloth, and the judge telling him, "You stole the sheep, now what is happening?" And it's really a beautiful play. I learned it in the 1980s, and I still remember certain phrases from this play. For example, the phrase that we use now in French called "revenons à nos moutons," which means "come back to our sheep." The judge keeps saying that, "Let's come back to our sheep. Why are you going away to cloth and other things? Let's come back to our sheep." So when students enjoy a play, they memorize certain sentences that stay with them for life. The next you can work on is Molière. Molière is a comedy playwright from the 17th century. Les Fourberies de Scapin is a lovely play, but I'm sure you have your favorites when it comes to Molière. Molière's language is very easy. So I suggest that you take one or two scenes and put them together, and you can rewrite it a little bit, and you can help your students stage it up. Voyage de Monsieur Perrichon, we've already seen it. Simple plays of the 20th century, we've already seen that. And there have been many plays that I've discovered online. I even have a small volume in my department library. They've been written by teachers, and they have a didactic purpose, and they're very simple things. For example, once we put up a play about two people, a man and a wife, and she had a lover, and the lover and the husband start fighting on who she loves more. So they decide to pretend to kill themselves. But when they pretend to kill themselves, she runs off with the butler. So it's a lovely play. It's a very funny play. And the lexic was beautiful, very simple. Students enjoyed putting it up. Students enjoyed watching it. Or if you don't want to use any of these plays, with the help of your students, you can write your own. How do you write your own? Once again, you have to concentrate on groups. You can give them picture prompters. I found these two online. Look at the imagination that can be provoked when you show them a flying house. Or you can work on other more serious elements, like, for example, an environmental documentary about a poor owl that lost his house, and ask them to write a one-act play on a house that flies or an owl that lost it. And there's so many other pictures that you can find online that will help them provoke their imagination. Now, you will ask me, why stage a play? We'll do the show the role in class. Why stage a play outside the classroom? Because language teachers like us nowadays are under a heavy onus. There's a huge onus on us. And what is that? We have to describe our teaching activities on par with major departments. Now, everybody's talking nowadays about performance-based education and experiential learning and participatory learning. Now, we cannot send our students out for an internship in which they perform, they experience, they participate, they learn. So the only way we can do that is if we give them that situation inside the college, but outside the class. So you give them a situation, you tell them to work together as a team and present a play, they perform, they learn by experience, and they participate together, and it promotes learning. Now, another thing that it's a positive when you're staging a play is, like I told you, you have huge classes. You have 70 students sometimes in a class. You have 10, 20 advanced learners. You have some very poor learners. You have learners who are hardly there in class because they're always on the football field or the basketball field, or they're dancing or singing somewhere. So when you make them come together as groups and tell them, "Today we're working on the theme of buying in the shop," and you give the advanced learners who know how to speak and know how to emote, and they have to teach their classmates. This gives the advanced learners something to do. They don't get bored in class because they're planning something to do in the future. And it also promotes peer learning, because once I remember there was a girl who just could not pronounce bonjour. She could not pronounce bonjour. I tried to tell her that she could pronounce the word treasure. She said treasure beautifully, but she could not take the je from the treasure and speak it inside bonjour. So finally I told her group, I said, "You're not leaving the class." It was a one last hour class, I told them, you're not leaving at 1:30 until she pronounces bonjour correctly. I do not know how they did it, but I had failed. I'd been teaching that girl for more than a week and she could not pronounce the je. But at the end, at 1:30 correctly, she came up to me and she took part in a role play with her classmates, and her role was only saying the bonjour, como ça va. So pure learning is a very big thing that we have to, that we can easily glean, exploit and use inside the classroom. And when you stage a play inside the classroom or outside the classroom, it promotes all these aspects with which we are supposed to describe our learning to the authorities today. Our teaching will become performance based. It is experiential learning, participatory. The children participate and learn. Advanced learners get a chance to train their peers, and it adds creativity to a literary extract. Now, what are the advantages of using theater as a teaching tool? Number one, it boosts memory. Nobody likes memorizing, but like I told you, the play I learned in the 1980s, I still remember it today. So sentences that a child learns and memorizes in happiness because she's performing with her friends and she says it, she still repeats it to me after two or three semesters and even after she has stopped learning French. It boosts self-confidence because many of our students are very timid and they feel daunted by those who are able to speak a lot. So if you give them theater as a role, as a teaching tool, and you say, yes, you can speak, and I'm giving you the words that you're going to speak, and I'm going to teach you how to speak them, it boosts self-confidence, and it also improves communication skills. Because I've seen that when a play or a show the role is happening and one girl forgets her lines, her friends help her, or they improvise, and they overcome that lacunae in her presentation. As we've said before, you can use it to push girls to use their imagination so that teaching is no longer boring. They can use their imagination. Theater and acting plays boosts team group work, which is so essential today in our world. It is fun, and it's a chance to work together outside the classroom setting. Now, in my college, I will just talk about this and then I will end this presentation. We had a dramatics day now that we put up, and my rule was that each class, we have four classes, each class should put up a play. And we had various groups. We had the ideas groups, the big bossy types who have a lot of ideas but they can't write well. We had the writers groups. Now here you should limit the people. You can't have too many of them because too many cooks have too many plots and nobody knows what's happening. So although you form groups, I think the teacher should be there in the groups, helping them think about ideas, one or two ideas, blend them together and make the writers know what they have to write about. Offline, we had props and costumes. Online, I don't know how we're going to do that. Maybe we can think about using students who know how to draw to visualize backstage or pictures or slides that can be used in class. There was a music and a dance group. We had a group for the PPT, and we also had the actors and the readers. And this was the poem we worked on. It was a poem by Le Comte de Lille, and the poem is called Lac de Shiva. It's just four small poems, four small verses that have come. It's a huge long poem. We chose four short poems. And the first verse, I chose the first four, I'm blabbering. It's a long poem and I chose four verses. The first verse was about the Raksha from Lanka who came to steal, abduct Sita and carry her away. So this is about him dancing around with a huge club and his mouth is shouting with rage. And the second verse is about Rama, who's very calm and he is white and fair and beautiful in comparison to the black and hideous Raksha. And the third verse is about how he killed him with the arrow, La Flèche. And the final verse was about how the Raksha dies after getting shot with the arrow. So what my students did with this was they thought about a play in three acts. In the first act, you had a group of youngsters wondering what to do, and they decided to go for a movie. And what was the movie? It was called Actress Shiva, and the director was Le Comte de Lille. And when you go to the movie theater, they buy their popcorn and they settle down, and the movie starts, and you have Rama and the Raksha dancing to Bharatanatyam music. You had the Apsaras also dancing in the background, and finally the battle is won. And the third act was the students on stage discussing the movie. So all these themes were what they had learned in class, how to discuss together and plan how to go out, how to criticize a movie or a book, and finally the poem itself. It was a wonderful experience. This is the photo of the group that did the play, Lak the Shiva. And I also have a photo because you see, we found out that there's some girls who like speaking, but they're too scared to act. So they were the readers and they sat here in the pit and they gave the voiceover for certain activities. So people would act on stage and the voiceover will come here from the pit. And you also had the PPT with the scenes and extra comments and all here. So the audience who could not hear or understand what was happening could read and see what was happening. So we had four plays. One was Ark the Shiva. One was play that was based on a short story from North Africa. And the main character was Nazruddin Mulla, who is a favorite in Indian short stories also. We had a play called La Parure from Guy de Maupassant, and we also had a first year's putting up a play on a group of tourists who got lost in Paris. So see the diversity of their ideas and how they got together and they performed. Was their pronunciation perfect? No. But at the end, even today, I have girls telling me their lines, Je voudrais du popcorn, and Où est mon âne, j'ai perdu mon âne. They memorized those lines and they spoke it out and they remember it today. And finally, I think that is the role of any French or language teacher. Whatever you teach them in class, they should carry it with them beyond the classroom, beyond the exam, beyond the college. They should have those sentences with them in life. So one day if they happen to go to Paris and they're lost, they would think of, you know, what happened in that play, and they will say, Je suis perdu, est-ce que vous pouvez m'aider? You know, all these things help students. When they memorize a line, it stays in their mind. When they memorize a line, it stays in their mind and they're able to use it later whenever the situation occurs. In our college, we also have a class journal. So you can also reproduce their acting play, their drama into a in-house journal, and you can publish it online now. You don't need to think about how many copies you have to print because you don't have the money. Everything now is possible online. So these are various ideas on how you can use theater in the classroom. You can use them either if they're there in the syllabus. If it's not in the syllabus, I encourage you to use it as a supplementary mode of learning. And if the students say there's no use in this, we're not going to use it in the exam, tell them, let's put up a play, everybody will enjoy it. Or we'll bring it out and as a journal at the end of the academic year. And this gives them added impetus to listen to you and cooperate. So this is the end of my presentation. I hope it has given you ideas. I hope it has opened your mind on various ways we can use theater inside the classroom, outside the classroom. You can see that now we cannot say anymore that I don't have it, I don't have my textbook, everything is there online. There are ways and means in which we can use our basic teaching concepts and make children listen to us and work in virtual small mini rooms. And I'm sure if we put our brain into it, we'll be able to come up with better ideas to use theater in the classroom. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Thank you so much, ma'am. With that, we will move on. You're getting a lot of wonderful and overwhelming feedback in the comments. Your presentation was very enthusiastic. You have come up with a lot of innovative, practical solutions to teach French. We will have a short Q&A session of 10 to 15 minutes, ma'am. Off the bat, let me tell you, there were two questions which were repeatedly asked in the chat stream right from the beginning. One was, what could be the possible differences between English and French theater? And the other was how to make shy students, because theater is generally it is something that where you have to express yourself, and many students are very shy. So how to make beginners who are shy speak and express themselves using this theater as a tool for teaching?
The first question, I'm not an expert on English theater. I know a little bit of Shakespeare because I learned it in school and college, but apart from that, I have no idea about English theater. But earlier once when I presented French poetry, there was a young person who asked me the difference between English and French poetry. So those of you who are interested in research and comparative studies, maybe you can take this up and see the differences between French and English poetry and theater. That is not a big difference, because when I was preparing this presentation, I went to this website, Britannica, in which drama has been presented from the European point of view. So it's not only France or England, but Germany and Italy and all the European countries who are big in drama. And when I was reading it, I realized that there's not really much difference. But in France, since I've studied it, I can clearly tell you what happened in the medieval age, in the 16th century and the 17th century. I know that there was romanticism that was widespread in the 19th century, and there was a Renaissance mood which was widespread in the 16th century. I know Shakespeare, but apart from that, I don't know much about English poetry, so I don't think I can comment to you on this. But I feel that when you're an English teacher or a French teacher, you are trying to teach competencies to your students. So whatever competency you're trying to teach, you can use theater now to launch your thoughts and make your students, provoke them to learn and to repeat and to say. And the second question was on, what was the second question?
How to make shy students who are beginners come express themselves when you use theater as a tool for teaching.
Yes, yes, very, very, very correct. That is something I really struggle with. Timid students, sometimes they're very intelligent students, they have beautiful ideas, but they just are too scared. They come and stand in front of you and they literally tremble. I've seen it happen, so I can perfectly empathize with you. You have to see, we language teachers, we have students with us for 4 semesters. So don't force them. In the beginning, what I do is I just give them things like hold up a chart, or you want to be the server, the waiter, come in with a tray. Let them get rid of their stage fright. If they want to act, but they say, I'm too scared to open my mouth. In the first 2 semesters, give them ideas that they do not, give them roles in which they don't need to speak much. But finally, when they come to the 3rd and 4th semester, I see that these girls are the ones who now have the courage to come forward and perform on stage. And if they're still shy, give them a voiceover option. They sit in the pit, they sit in the sidelines, and they give the voiceover for somebody who they can do the narration. If your play is going to be people on stage speaking, you can give them the narration role, because there's always a narrator in a play. But that is how you can bring out timid students. It takes a lot of effort, but do it in stages. Don't just say, no, you're going to do this today. You have to introduce it to them first semester something, second semester, and then when they come to the 3rd year, they're used to it and they're ready to do what you want them to do.
The next question, I'll just make it appear on the screen, ma'am. Can you see that?
Yes, yes, yes. L'apprentissage de théâtre sera-t-il utile dans les perspectives de carrière? Yes, it is very useful. I'll tell you why. I was closely associated with the Alliance the previous 8 years. And there is a strong connection between the Alliance and Indian artists. And many theatre dramas have been put up in collaboration between French artists and Indian artists. And they work on plays. They work on French plays and they present them here in India. Or the Indian artist works on an Indian play and they present it here. And sometimes they have the opportunity to go to France also and present it. And many of the playwrights I know just two, I don't know many, I just know two. But all of them have a strong French background. And one of the colleges in my city 2 years back had done a theater workshop for second language French students. So you can see that it is there. It is there. We just have to tap it and we have to show our students that there's a possibility. It is there. I hope that clarifies
the next question, ma'am. The role of E.
What is the role of E? Is it pronunciation point of view?
You were mentioning about E, the sound of E, that it has, that it is distorted and all that.
Okay. It's not the sound E. It's a very funny sound. It's a E. You drag it down. It comes like in travaille and champignon. And you know, it's a very French sound. It's not that, I don't think, I've not come across it in English yet. Maybe it's there, but I've not figured it out. And it's a sound that many students find difficult to say, because when they come across a spelling like travailler, TR, for those who don't know French, I will type it here. Will they see it, Walter? Travailler?
Yes, you can type it in the chat.
Okay, so you have things like travailler, and you have words like fee, and students do not pronounce this well. They say travailler, travailler. They pronounce the L, or they pronounce the double L in the fee. They say fil instead of fee. And if you give them a more complicated word like champignon, where you have once again this E, they are lost. So it's a word, it's a sound that students don't like, and teachers find it difficult to teach it to them. So that first extract that we worked on, you can use it to show them that there are ways to pronounce it and use it in theater. How the role play helps trainers to teach. This is, when we were doing BA French club, when I was a part of a BA French team, it was easier. See, as a second language teacher, my options are limited because I have beginners in my class. At the BA French level, you have, and I meet my students now maybe once a day. Whereas a BA French student, they have no choice but to look at my face for at least 5 to 6 hours in a day. So the possibility with a BA French teacher, with a BA French class or any French class is huge compared to a second language teacher like me, who just meets the student once a day for the whole week, or maybe sometimes we meet them only 4 times a day. For the whole week. So it is very easy to take a theater, a proper theater, proper drama, and make your students act it out at the BA French level or at the MA French level, whereas it is progressively more difficult for a second language student to do it. In fact, when I was an MA student, I remember we put up a beautiful drama. I think it was Rhinoceros. Yes, it was Rhinoceros. We did the whole play. So the possibilities, I've seen students at the BA French level do Silapadigaram in French. So the possibilities are huge. There are lots of online sites to learn French, many, but I won't recommend. I can recommend the Alliance because I know that they do online classes and I know those classes are good. But apart from that, I think you need a good online teacher. And right now, when I'm trying to understand how to do online teaching, I don't think I am a good teacher online, so I cannot recommend anything to you. But I know that the Alliance Francaise classes are really good, so that can help you. But there are many sites, there are many videos on YouTube, but you need somebody to guide you, because sometimes the pronunciation is not good, the translations are not good. So I don't recommend anything to you. You have to work with someone.
Time for one last question.
Yes, 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 please. Yes, this is a good suggestion. Create a database of students performing, play these videos to online. Okay, that's a very good thing. You can do it, yes. In fact, role plays earlier, when I did it about 2-3 years back, I had a group of very enthusiastic students. So I told them, okay, let's take the role play out of the class. You go. If you're going on a picnic, pretend you go to a park, take a video and send me the video, and I share the video with the students on WhatsApp. So now we can do the same, but then online our options are limited because the children cannot meet. So I don't know how we're going to do it now, but there are, because we have the concept of breakout rooms and mini Google Meets and all that, possibilities are there. And now the in thing is to have virtual choirs in which people from various countries and various cities, they come together and sing a song. So why don't we have a play also like that? You have small windows with the father speaking and the mother speaking, and you can have somebody draw the background as a slide. So there are beautiful possibilities. I think if we just think and put it online, we can take a recording and we can show it to, we can use that actually as a document to teach with for our future students.
Thank you so much, ma'am. With that, we come to the end of the Q&A session. It was a very enthusiastic presentation, and as well as you have answered most of the queries which were there in the chat stream. Rama ma'am, your kind comments, ma'am.
Yes, yes, Walter. I mean, I think one word I can say is completely floored by the way Adeline ma'am presented the whole thing, because what I basically felt was It was not just, French language teaching, as she very often mentioned. I think it's for all language teachers. So many insights you have given, ma'am, and you have flooded us with so many ideas that we'll really have to think about it, recall, revisit them, and use them. Excellent. Very, very, very nice. And thank you so much for joining us, ma'am. Thank you so much.
It's a pleasure, ma'am. Thank you for inviting me.
Thank you, Rama, ma'am. Shall we move on to the formal vote of thanks?
Yes.
I kindly request Dr. Savita, Assistant Professor, Department of English and Other Foreign Languages, to deliver the vote of thanks. Over to you, ma'am.
Thank you, Walter. A very good afternoon to everyone present here. On behalf of the Department of English and Other Foreign Languages, SRM Institute of Science and Technology, Ramapuram, I deem it a great privilege to deliver the vote of thanks. This FDP is meant to disseminate the impact of language and literature on the 21st century learners. The talk by Dr. Adeline Albert on the role of theatre in French language teaching today has immensely enhanced and inspired the participants. Both acting and language learning involve self-expression and require a willingness to take chances, because we risk our psychological well-being every time we try to speak. We are extremely grateful to you, ma'am, for sharing the choice of techniques that can be applied to teaching through your insightful address. My sincere thanks to our management and the heads of the institution for the unwavering support extended from time to time in all the programs that we organize. I am very much thankful to our head of the department, Dr. Rama, for her generous support and inspiring mentorship, which have greatly helped towards organizing this FDP. My heartfelt thanks and my sincere appreciations to Dr. Walter, joint coordinator, who has given this idea of hosting this week-long FDP. Mention must be made of the untiring effort taken by him to support me personally and to many others in the department for all the events organized so far under the banner EFL. I profusely thank Ms. Preeta Basu for lending her generous support to handle the technical part. I sincerely thank all my colleagues in the department for their enthusiasm and valuable suggestions. I thank all the participants from across the world for showing their interest to join us in the FDP. I am sure that the participants must have really benefited through this, and I request you all to join us tomorrow. Thank you all once again.
Thank you, ma'am. With that, we come to the end of this session, this live webinar. Adeline ma'am and Rama ma'am, kindly you can leave the studio by clicking on the option.
Oh, okay, thank you. Thank you, ma'am, Adeline ma'am.
Yes. Savita ma'am, thank you so much, ma'am. You can leave the studio, ma'am. I will stay in the broadcast till the feedback can be accessed.
Okay, Walter. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, ma'am.